Good evening, and welcome to something completely different. Top of the Air tonight is, as they say, somewhere in England, and as you can see, on a typical summer's day. We're here to put a very special group of vehicles through their paces. Now, if you've been browsing through your motoring magazines, or in fact, if you've been into the King's Road recently, you'll know that we're in the middle of a four-wheel drive phenomenon. Suddenly, the Debs and the Withitt families seem as keen as the farmers to get the trend-setting vehicles like the Sinpar, the Subaru, and of course, old favourites like the Land Rover and the Jeep. Four-wheel drive seems to be here for the weekends as well as for work days. So we've collected eight of these vehicles. They're from France, they're from Japan, from Russia, from America, and of course from Britain. And we're going to put them through a very special Top Gear trial. We've got here in Dorset, in this tank country, sand, gravel, a water splash, and as you'd expect on an English summer's day, lots of mud and lots of water. We designed this Top Gear track to test every facet of four-wheel drive, from grip to ground clearance. It begins with this plunge down the gully, but you've got to be in first gear, because if you put your brakes on, you'll toboggan past this very tight left-hander. You've got to be able to manoeuvre around. It's thick, sticky mud. It's quite a bump there, and you've got to move your way around before you then leap down onto the basin of this superb track here. Now this, as you can see, is bumpy, it's slippery, it's treacherous. That really is a skiddy mud, and it's on into a water splash. It's about a foot of 18 inches deep of water, and of course you've got to be careful not to drown the engine. Up over the bump, and then we put a chicane in through these concrete posts here. The car's got to wind through the chicane, and the next hazard facing it is a lot of slippery ferns as we climb up a short slope. At the top of this slope, there's a 90-degree right-hander, and this brings you down to the bed of the valley again, where there are two large bumps to catch anyone unawares. There's one, and there's another. Now, a quick spin round to be facing the right way for a slope which is sticky, glutinous sand, which really tugs at the traction and loses an awful lot of power. It just seems to suck the power out of the cars. Then we've got a long right-hand hairpin. With a couple of nasty bumps there. It's an adverse camber, and you can see one bump, and now another one. So you're then using first gear probably for braking before you come back down again to the floor of this forgotten valley. You almost expect dinosaurs to appear here. But the strange creatures we're studying are these four-wheel drive vehicles, and they've got a very special test indeed. They come across a bit of the valley and then to this dreadful one-in-two gully. And the question is, can any vehicle make it up this slope? This is the Japanese Subaru, and it's certainly the most unusual of the vehicles in today's trial. As you can see, it looks like any normal estate car with a 1600cc engine, top speed of 90 miles an hour, and two-star petrol. But it can be converted to four-wheel drive just by pushing a little lever at any speed up to 50 miles an hour. And the man who's pushed that lever is Tony Fowkes, the 38-year-old rally driver, who's now going to put this car through its paces, perhaps as never before. If you look at the right hand of your screen, you'll see that we've got a stopwatch on all these cars down the gully. Now, there's a very sharp turn there, which in practice this morning some of the cars missed. The bumping down into the bottom of this natural basin here. Very rough indeed, but the Subaru riding it quite nicely. A good speed there, and onto the water splash where Tony Fowkes tells me he has to slow down else he could completely drown the engine. That's about 18 inches of water, swinging round through the chicane we've built for them here, through concrete bollards. A complete right-hander, and then he's got to climb the slippery slope up through the ferns, which is very treacherous indeed. Going very well indeed, just a normal four-speed gearbox and a very tight turn there before he comes back onto very bumpy bits with these little wheels. There is, of course, underbody protection for this car before he hurls it round left to approach a slope that looks okay, but it's thick sand, and as Tony said, it just sucks away the power from this car with only a 1600cc engine. We now have a long right-hand hairpin. It's adverse camber, and there are a couple of stings in the tail, a bump there, and now another big bump, which really sets the car rocking. But Tony Fanks, of course, the man who was second in the London-Sydney Marathon, and is in fact preparing to go on a 30,000-kilometre rally right around South America, starting in the Argentine. But now he's coming to the tricky bit. He's got to get speed up for this gully. He's got to go as fast as he can, but he's got to keep the wheels on the ground to hold traction, and it's very bumpy indeed. Putting up a very good time, still under 2 minutes, but he's stuck. I think it's only fair to say at this point that a car of this nature isn't really intended to climb what is virtually a tank trap, but he made a tremendous effort. This is the second of the, what we might call the conventional-looking cars, the Renault Sinphar. As you can see, it's based on a Renault 6 with the normal 1100cc engine, 40 brake horsepower, top speed of 85 miles an hour, 38 miles per gallon. But the difference is that it's converted. In France, they've been converting these cars for years. Now you can have it done in Scotland, in Perth to be exact, and the man who sells them is a man who's at the wheel. It's Charles Cruikshank. He's 23 from Perth. He's driven it all the way down from there, and he's hoping that this bumpy Top Gear trial is going to leave the car in fit condition to get back home again tonight. The conversion, of course, began for vans, for people like gamekeepers, etc. The car can be operated in both two-wheel drive and four-wheel drive, and you can convert it if you find yourself in a situation like this, for example, to four-wheel drive at speeds of up to 30 miles an hour. But Charles Cruikshank is, of course, driving on four-wheel drive all the time at the moment. The car is stronger than normal Renault 6. It's been strengthened. It's got heavy-duty shock absorbers, which he's certainly needing on this course. It's got a sump guard, which he might not need on this little bit, but as he comes around this corner, you'll find it gets very bumpy indeed as he comes back into this natural basin, bounces over two little gullies there. He's taking it very steadily. He knows it's a long way back to Perth from here in Dorset. And now he's got to use all the power he's got, all the brake horsepower, to climb up this very sandy slope, which seems to just tug at these cars and almost defy the traction that this four-wheel drive is giving them. Well, he's still under 2 minutes, but he's got to go around that long hairpin and then plunge down back to the basin. But he's been taking it easy. Probably saw what happened to the Subaru. The price of this car, by the way, is £4,300, and they do it for most of the Renault range. They do it for the Renault 4, you can do it for the Renault 12, and of course for the Renault vans. And the efficiency of that four-wheel drive is really seen here. It looks so easy, but that is a slippery, treacherous, muddy surface. You know what the English summer weather's been like. It's been dreadful. And now, can it pass the ultimate test? Climb up this gully. It's a 1-in-2 slope. Lots of bumps. You can lose traction if you lift a wheel off it. And I think he's going to crawl to a halt there. And yes, he is. 2 minutes. 0.8 seconds, but I'm afraid that the Renault Sinphar hasn't passed the ultimate test. But of course, this isn't really fair to cars like this one. The next time you see this car will be at the Birmingham Motor Show. It's the Lada Niva, and it isn't really on the market in this country yet. This is our Russian challenger today. And as you'd expect, if you've ever seen Russian roads, either in reality or on film, it's a strong and sturdy vehicle, and it needs to be both tough and nimble. Its dimensions are very good. It's 12 feet 2 inches long and 5 foot 6 inches wide, which means it's very parkable. And it's hoped to be sold over here at under £4,000, which isn't bad for a car with permanent four-wheel drive. Its top speed is nearly 80, it's not a bad ride, and it's got very light steering. And the man who's driving it is a man who's a bit of an expert on what he calls all-wheel driving. It's Chris Amory. He's 26 from Ealing. He works for a car recovery service firm and is used to going out in four-wheel drive vehicles. And certainly this Russian car is putting up a very good time now, still under a minute, and he's in the ferns, but it's a very tight turn, this, and then it gets very bumpy indeed. Not that Chris Amory will be worrying about this at the moment, but it is a very easy car to park. It's got a 36-foot turning circle, and it should certainly help at the top of this slope when we get the very tight right-handed hairpin. Well, we haven't had any of the cars yet beat the end of the test, but certainly this car's going well. You can hear it grumbling a little as he goes for the engine braking here to get down a slope, which is very slippery indeed. gets at the bottom of this huge natural base, and it really is the ideal spot for a test like this. And I can assure you, if you tried to drive a normal car across that bed, you'd be in trouble indeed. But this is where the trouble has struck most people, climbing this 1-in-2 gully. He's seeking a first gear here to try and have a good run at it. He's got to keep his wheels on the deck to keep the traction. This is where the other two contenders have stuck. Is he going to make it? He's just gone out. And that is a superb performance. 2 minutes 2.6 and the first car to complete the course. This is the Daihatsu, and you don't have to look at it long to realise that it's a copy of the Jeep. It is one of the cheapest cars we're going to see today. It sells at under £4,000, and of course the time it has to beat at 2 minutes 02.6 seconds. It has a 1600cc engine and a manual gearbox, and it's got nippy dimensions, as you can see, 11.5 feet long, 6 feet wide, and we're told it can get up to 72 miles an hour and average 26 miles per gallon on two-star petrol. It also can be either a two-wheel drive car or a four-wheel drive car. In four-wheel drive at the moment, of course, but you can actually, if you find yourself in this sort of situation, change into four-wheel drive at any speed up to 40 miles an hour. The driver is David Howes, who I remember as a saloon car racer driving American Javelins. He also competed in a Jeep in the London to Sydney Marathon and finished 23rd. Of course, that was a lot longer than this half-mile course, and he's really setting the pace at the moment. It's got very good ground clearance, as you can see. It's got big wheels, and this really is the first of the, if you like, conventional four-wheel drive vehicles, as opposed to the Lada, which set that time of 2 minutes, not 2.6 seconds. Now, can he beat it? He's really going to have to go some. He's got this long, tight hairpin here, a couple of big bumps and jumps coming up, which shouldn't bother this Daihatsu. It is available, by the way, in hard top as well as soft top. And let's hope you can have a roll bar, which you would need for a situation like this. Now, a quick flick to the left onto this treacherous, skiddy surface. I wonder how many of the Rallycross brethren would manage to complete this course. Still well under the 2 minutes. Remember, 2 minutes, not 2.6 seconds to beat. And he's on his way to the big climb up the gully. And if he can make it, surely he's going to beat that time. He's climbed. Is he stuck? Is he going to make it? He's just clawing his way to the top. And he stopped, dropped a gear. Can he? That must be one of the most frustrating drives that he has ever had. Well, for David Howes, it really was a case of so near, so far. He just failed at the lip of that gully. But now here he is again, seeking revenge in the most exotic of the cars on view today, the Cherokee Chief. As its name implies, it really can carry a canoe, a pile of saddles, or any of the outdoor gear you might associate with such an exotic big brother from the Jeep family. It is, of course, as you can see, America's answer to the Range Rover. And it has two advantages. One is that it comes in four-door as well as two-door versions, and the other is that it's readily available. It's 15 feet long and it's over 6 feet wide, but as you can see, it's got tremendous power, 5.9 litres of V8 power, and a top speed of about 90 miles an hour. In fact, it can accelerate from 0 to 60 in under 12.2 seconds. And, as you might expect from an American vehicle, it's got automatic transmission, it's got power steering, and it's got a high and a low range to give you 6 speeds. You can select gears to give you engine braking, which is necessary here, and then use up automatic control again to give you the pace he's going to need to climb up that slippery, sandy slope, which tugs at the traction, but should be no problem at all for a car with all this power. It costs £9,499, which makes it dearer than the Range Rover. But it's got something called quadra-track differential lock. What that means is it can sense where the power is needed and push it through the wheels. Well, at the moment, of course, what it needs is engine braking as it comes down here. The rain is now lashing down. What a beautiful, typical English summer's day for this vehicle that was surely built for Californian beaches and the backwoods. But at the moment, as far as David Howes is concerned, is he going to make it up this gully? He failed to do it before in the smaller vehicle. Can he do it in this big one, which has really got power on its side? The rain absolutely lashing down. That's treacherously slippery.
And is it going to make it? This is where he failed last time. It's clawing, it's struggling. It looks as if it's stopped. And again, for David Howes, 1 foot proved 1 foot too much. Well, there are no prizes for guessing what this vehicle is. Of course, it's the Jeep. Really the vehicle that began it all and made today's programme possible. But will it be possible for David Howes, who's having his third successive drive, to complete the course this time? Twice he's been so near and yet so far. And let me remind you that to date only one car has completed the course, the Lada Niva, and the time for that was 2 minutes, 2.6 seconds. But if it's pedigree you're looking for, I suppose you can't really beat the Jeep. The very name has become part of motoring and military folklore. All that's missing today really is John Wayne or those people from MASH. Today's Jeep has all the toughness of the military vehicle, but offers such soft civilian options as automatic transmission, power steering and power brakes. It is, of course, built for the Californian Beach Brigade, but it's also a workhorse. You can even get this vehicle with a snowplow attached. The one we're watching now, driven by David Howes, is the basic CJ7 hardtop. It costs £4,989. It's got a six-cylinder engine, 4.2 litres, a top speed of 85 miles an hour, and of course it's got two-wheel and four-wheel drive. And this Jeep has a three-speed gearbox. It is, in fact, the refined relative of perhaps the most famous vehicle in World War II. But as far as David Howes is concerned, the battle is to complete the course, not just quickly, but actually to get there. He must be feeling very angry indeed that on two occasions he's made it all but for the last foot. This car is, of course, lighter than the last one he tried and has got plenty of horsepower. And, of course, the ground clearance is absolutely ideal. People who remember driving rather less civilized versions of this vehicle in the war will know that they seem to cope with any situation. But the question at top gear is, can it, in bottom gear, cope with this situation? Our dreadful gully with the rain lashing down, terribly slippery. You can just see how slippery. And the problem is, when you bounce like that, you lose traction. He seems to have picked it up, and he's done it, and he's over! And so, David Howes has not only completed the course at a third attempt in three vehicles, but completed it in 1 minute, 54 seconds. And the vehicle that's trying to beat it is the first of the British entries, the Range Rover, which is, of course, one of Britain's most wanted vehicles, both home and abroad. Behind the wheel, Chris Horn, a 33-year-old press car department driver of JRT, the new company Jaguar Rover Triumph. He used to, in fact, race a Ginetta, which is quite a different proposition from this Range Rover. This elegant vehicle has perhaps been in demand ever since it was introduced in 1970. They've built nearly 70,000 since then, and 75% have been exported. And when you see the way it tackles that sort of terrain, you can see why. What is its appeal that's made it the darling of the King's Road, as well as the farmers and the gamekeepers and the cross-country people with real work to do? Well, it's certainly got style. In fact, one Range Rover was actually exhibited at the Louvre as a work of art. It's comfortable and it's fast. It will cruise on an autostrada at 100 miles an hour. I've driven one in London, and the visibility at places like Hyde Park Corner in traffic is superb. It isn't cheap, it's £9,150. But that buys a very exclusive vehicle, and a vehicle with this V8 engine, 3.5 litres, 130 horsepower, which is really eating up this circuit at the moment, looking for a British victory in this, our first Top Gear trial. Chris Horn being very careful over those two bumps that follow an adverse camber, sliding down into the bottom of this valley, which is getting more treacherous by the minute, not only because of the weather, but because of the other vehicles that have been across it. And now let's just see how the Range Rover copes with this dreadful gully in these appalling conditions. Perfect at the moment, but a sideways slide, scrabbling, clawing his way ever so slowly, and he's made it. And according to my watch, he's just 0.3 of a second behind the winning time, and you can't get closer racing, if you can call this racing, than that. And so for the last of our challenges, 1 minute, 54 seconds to beat, and it's our friend the Land Rover. More than 1 million have been built, and it must be one of the most wanted vehicles in the world. At the wheel, Roger Craythorne. Now he's taking this in first, wants to avoid the brakes, otherwise you toboggan past this sharp turning here, as people did in practice this morning. He's made it, so he can now change to second and then to third as he hits the flat by comparison, I should say. Bumpy, muddy, treacherous, but no problem at all for the Land Rover. Through the water splash, sort of picture that we must have seen in Land Rover adverts time and time again. This is the short wheelbase, the 88-inch version, the station wagon. Four cylinders, a 2.25-litre engine, producing 67 brake horsepower with a top speed of 68 miles per hour. They're spending more than £250 million to increase production of this vehicle because there is scarcely a market anywhere in the world that doesn't want a Land Rover in one form or another. You can, of course, select four-wheel drive or two-wheel drive with this versatile vehicle, and certainly its toughness has never been in question. This one would cost you £5,303, but for that, it will take you virtually anywhere. Now he's negotiated that hairpin down the slope. Remember, 1:54 to beat. This is the last chance for a British victory, Land Rover versus Jeep. The Land Rover was built in 1948 for the first time, when people had got used to Jeeps, built with aluminium body panels because there wasn't any steel at that time. It still has that feature. So Land Rover versus Jeep, well up to time. 14 seconds to get up this gully. 1:54 to beat, 10 seconds. 8 seconds, still climbing, no problem, got the grip, sliding from side to side, he's edging over, and he's won! 1:53.9, what could be closer than that? 0.1 of a second, and the Land Rover wins the first ever Top Gear trial for four-wheel drive vehicles. Well, the Top Gear course has been loaned to us by the British Army. Well, this isn't a vehicle you'd really want down the King's Road, although I can think of traffic situations where I'd love to have one. It's an armoured car with a three-man crew and a 30mm cannon. And he's in it. How's he going to get out of this? He's going to need all his skill to get out of this one. And he isn't. Well, I think he's all right. And nobody's hurt. Well, that's the main thing. But that surely shows just what a fierce test today's Top Gear trial has been. And so we've seen that even four-wheel drive vehicles and their professional drivers are not infallible. But four-wheel driving most certainly can be fun. And we'd like to offer Top Gear's congratulations to all the drivers and all the cars that have competed so manfully in the mud today. And of course, particular congratulations to Roger Craythorne, who won in the Land Rover. And what better way to end our first Top Gear trial than by the traditional champagne. We hope you've enjoyed watching these four-wheel drive vehicles in action. We hope you might one day enjoy driving them. From Top Gear, amidst the mud, the champagne and the bubbles. Good night.